Before we get on to the agenda, just like to make all members aware that this meeting is being recorded, so we will be on our best behaviour this evening, not that we aren't at other meetings.
Can I just say, can you speak up, because there's a lot of people here that want to listen, and that's not here.
So before we get into the meat of the meeting, for obvious reasons, I think members might understand if we would like to change the agenda to bring a certain item forward, which is in relation to the firework and the review which is going on. Are members happy to amend the agenda items, bring that forward after we've had other questions?
Great.
Excellent. So with that in mind, hopefully everyone's had a chance to review the minutes of the previous meeting. Any objections? We're happy for us to sign that.
My definition is to say group, not on.
What?
We can't hear you.
Council of Houston's declaration of interest currently reads as being a member of the Barnet Group, Barnet Homes Board, and should read as a member of the Barnet Group Board, so we can make that change in the minutes of the last meeting.
Okay. Do members have any interest they wish to declare at the beginning of the meeting? I'll go from right through to left. Councillor Mitra. That's your colleagues. And if members are stating their declaration, they can say in which item it relates to.
Thank you, Chair. Can I declare three different interests? One being that I am a Barnet Homes tenant, and that relates to items number 6, 7, 8, my personal guess is 6, 7, 8. My second declaration is
just to clarify, you are the tenant, not the member of property.
Sorry?
Just to clarify, you are a Barnet Homes tenant.
Well, my mother is. My second declaration is that I, for employment, I work at the Greater London Authority. I'm declaring that in relation to item number 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and 12. Specifically, I'd like to declare under item 6, which relates to the Grenfell Tower item, that I work for Andrew Disbord in Germany, he's a member of the London Fire Emergency Planning Authority. Thank you. Maybe after tonight we can persuade you.
all that. So with regards to the public questions, Jan, do you want to read out the rules with regards to the public questions? We've got 7 questions for us this evening, and we'll see how we're doing for the timing of those 7.
So, Chairman, we've got the public questions before us. Basically, we take them as read, and then members of the public get the opportunity to ask one supplementary question each of the chairman. The total time allowed for public questions is usually 30 minutes. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you very much. With that in mind, Sorry to interrupt you, Chair.
Just to make you aware that we would very much like to make sure that all residents get to have their say in the cycling section, and if we do reach the 30-minute time limit, I think we will ask the sound orders to be suspended so that we can continue.
That's fine. I think we agree. I think that wasn't necessarily the official route to suspend sound orders, but perhaps we might all forget to look at the clock. So, with that in mind, I'd like to ask Ms. Basil to come to the table.
My question was whether Barnet is going to put in place best fire safety measures rather than only the minimum required, and will that be according to its center and inquiry as well as the documents? I got an answer. The answer was yes, basically, which I'm pleased about. And I ask you to specify what extra, because you say in your answer that approach capacity with the dwelling, housing committee is being asked to commit to a program of fire safety enhancements. Can you please specify what this enhancement is?
No, it's a very good question. So going forward over the next, I'd like to say a few weeks, maybe longer, we'll be working with the London Fire Brigade, and based on the recommendations that they are making to us, we'll be seeking to implement their advice as to what would make farming properties best in class. Does that answer the question?
No, you don't really specify. So, yep. Specifically, will you be investing in sprinklers, for instance, in old buildings?
Correct. So, whatever the fire brigade say would be the best fire prevention mechanism in a particular building, we would be seeking to implement their guidance. So if, as the example used here, then they say, yes, sprinklers in this building, we'd be seeking to implement that. If they say, no, sprinklers not in this building, I don't know what reason they would give, then we would say, okay, what would your advice be? So that's, I hope you appreciate, we as a committee would not be the experts in this area, but we'd be looking towards the experts to say, give us the guidance, and we would do our best to make funds available so that we can execute that guidance.
Right, so we're seeking, can we take it as commitment?
Yes.
Sorry,
yes.
Okay, this commitment to have the funding, thank you.
So I think you've got a second question there, but I think we've been under a few questions. If you'd like to ask.
I'd like to.
Okay.
Thank you.
In which case, did Ms. Howell's coming to the table, please?
Chair, as you can say, following advice and people we received from the monitoring officer.
Can't hear you.
Sorry, following advice we received from the monitoring officer during the session of the Labour Group earlier this week, we were informed that we obviously now need to declare if we know someone who's spoken in the committee. So I think I should be clear on behalf of all four members of the Labour Group that we know each other.
Okay,
yeah, we do.
I suppose I'll be the same as I know who she is as well. There we go. Let me get this one out of the way. Hello, everybody in the room. We now know all of you, and we take that all members have now acknowledged that they know members of the public who may speak at this committee. Do you agree?
Yeah.
Excellent. Sorry, it's Ms. Hand.
Hi, it was just to be, would it be possible to see the paperwork from the estate inspections of the town blocks in Barnet over the last 6 months, particularly as regards fire safety and the necessary repairs done to the communal areas as a result? I used to work at Barnet Homes as a housing officer, and I was just wondering, obviously things may have changed, but at the time the communal repairs picked up in the state inspections weren't, they weren't given as much priority as the repairs inside council properties, so I was just wondering if going forward there'd be more emphasis put on that.
We do have a very specific sort of approach to actions that come out of our risk assessments, and they're out of time limits. So depending on the urgency and the rating of each of the actions that are found, they will be given their priority order. So if something needs to be dealt with immediately, then it needs to be cleared within 10 days, and then so on from that in 6 months or 1 year. There are certain things that the fire brigade might, or that our risk assessors might recommend, but then there will be immediate things that need to be done. There might be things that need to be considered as part of the capital investment program moving forward, so it will be rolled up into the development and delivery of that program. So those actions are tracked very closely on a monthly and ongoing basis through an internal system that we have. So yes, in terms of what your sort of your description of how communal affairs were tracked previously, these will track very closely. And we can provide information in respect of actions following from fire risk assessments if that's what you'd like to say.
Thank you. Question three is from Alexandra Ben-Huda. Not here?
No.
Okay. That's question three. Question four is, David, would you like to attend the table?
Yeah, sorry about
the answer,
but
the answer was, it referred me, I mean, I asked what is the council going to do to ensure that private landlords comply with the highest standards of fire safety, and in your answer you referred me to the Grenfell Tower fire response, which had been published. I wasn't able to download it. I tried a few days ago and again today, thumbs up, so can you please answer the question now?
Just to clarify the question, are you asking what the council would do for private landlords to meet, the minimum fire safety standards, or to get them up to the same best in class that the council would
see? The highest
one, the best in class. Okay.
Following on from the recent tragedy, we have our building control and planning teams have trawled all of their databases to identify tall clad blocks and have written to the landlords of those blocks with the latest guidance. We don't have obviously the same sorts of powers to force people to go to a higher standard than the legislative requirements, but we are available to them to work with them for advice and guidance, and we certainly have drawn their attention to what they should be doing in response to the latest situation. So we're in touch with those landlords, but we can't force them to go above the statutory minimum.
And is it only regarding cladding, not regarding fire alarms, for instance? I happen to have a personal experience with very good building control inspectors that weren't actually that vigilant on the smoke alarms. So can you force this?
In some circumstances, so if they are, for example, a house and auto occupation, we have a licensing scheme which requires certain standards to be met, and we will inspect those and make sure they are meeting that standard. not every private block comes into that category. So in those cases, we only have the housing health and safety standards, which is a reactive service. If the tenant complained to environmental health, we would go and inspect the property, and if they failed to meet the standards, then there would be enforcement action. But for those units that aren't housing or for occupation, it would rely on tenants raising concerns.
And just to clarify, where do the tenants need to raise the complaints? Where should they contact? Who should they contact?
It's the you can do it through the website and through our contact centre. Is probably the most efficient way to get to the right person.
Questions 5, 6, and 7 were also from Alexander Ben Huda, so those are going to be taken either. That does bring us to the end of the list of questions I have in front of me at the moment. If members are happy, we will then move on to the Grenfell item. Are you happy with that?
Okay. Yeah.
Perfect. So, before we go into this item, I'd like to ask if best as the community can do to thank the Barnet officers, both Barnet Homes and Barnet Council, who have been working very, very long hours to ensure that we have the overview. We have late night phone calls, voicemails. It certainly hasn't been 9 to 5 for many of the staff involved in this. So, in as much of a capacity as we can do, I would like to say thank you to all the officers who've been involved in that. And then turning to the item. I'd like to ask, Kath, would you like to do an introduction to, or is this something much more appropriate?
I appreciate that the paper came out quite late because it's been a fast-moving situation, so I will give perhaps a slightly fuller overview than we normally do, particularly as members of the public may not have had a chance to see the report. So to start with Barnet Homes properties, Troy Elliott here, if there are detailed questions you know, but I can give an overview. We have identified 10 blocks, the 5 or more stories, with padding and external padding. Of those, 3 of the blocks have the same type of exterior rain stop padding, which is the outer layer of the padding system, as in the Grenfell tower situation. So those outer layers are sent off to DCLG for testing. I think it's important to stress that the padding system comprises not just the outer rain layer, but also the insulation layer and a series of fire breaks. In the case of Grenfell Tower, the insulation layer was also flammable. In the case of the Barnet Homes properties, which have a similar exterior padding, the insulation layer is made of mineral fibre insulation layers and rock wool. So those 3 towers, which are all in Grenfell Road Estate, although they do have the flammable exterior cladding, do have a rock wool insulation system, which gives a much, much greater degree of fire protection than was the case at Grenfell. However, the DCLG testing of that, the external layer, the samples did fail, and as a result of that, the DCLG triggered a London Fire Brigade inspection of those 3 towers. And I'm delighted to report that the London Fire Brigade, who inspected over the weekend, were very pleased with the standard of fire safety they found in the building. They did not raise any substantive new issues. And so, unlike some neighbouring boroughs, in particular, you've seen Camden on the news, where residents have to be evacuated, the advice from London Fire Brigade is that the building hasn't raised any issues and therefore we don't need to evacuate. So, we are aware that obviously this is an unsettling time for residents, and so we have put additional measures in place. As a precaution, we're committed to removing that flammable external layer, that also involves removing the insulation layer. We have Barnet Homes in place, fire watch wardens on the estate 24 hours, so there's always somebody to raise the alarm should a fire occur. And we've also put information initially in the church down the road, and then because that was really convenient to some residents, that was moved to a gazebo near Granville Point. So there is advice on site as well as fire warnings for residents. In the other seven clad blocks that we've identified, the cladding is of a different nature than Grenfell Tower. It's not believed to cause any concerns, although we have commissioned our independent tests of that to provide reassurance. And then the remaining tall buildings in the borough, are not clad. Vine hotels are not clad, and they're of brick construction predominantly. So we are not taking further action on the cladding aspect, because there is no cladding. We have updated the fire risk assessments on all of those blocks ahead of schedule, so they have an annual assessment anyway, this was done ahead of schedule. In terms of the housing associations in the borough, DCLG is coordinating similar exercise with housing associations than it is with councils, and we are also in contact with our housing associations, and my colleague Nikki Bird is in the audience and will be able to update on any feedback we've received from the housing associations if members have particular questions about that. In terms of the private blocks, as mentioned in the questions, we've written to all of the landlords and private blocks that we're aware that we're planning to set out the DCLG guidance, and we will continue to follow up on some blocks which residents and councillors have particularly pointed out, which is being ones that they would have concerns about. We will be more proactive with the landlords of those blocks. This is housing committee, so I won't go into detail on the non-housing buildings in the borough, but our work stream, our project to follow up on fire does also include looking at other blocks that we own particularly, and as a reference to Barnet House in the report, and also office blocks, schools, hospitals, and so on, in accordance with government guidance.
So with that overview, I'd like to asking questions. I've seen Hansgat from Councillor Rye, Mitra, Houston, and Angela, so we're going out of there to start with. Councillor
Rye. Thank you very much. I think probably we all want to, at this point, mark the very sad and loss of life at the Grenfell State. Rambo Road is in Charles Hill, which I represent, and I've spoken to resident association representatives who met with me today. And one of the issues that was raised with me was that whilst the robust procedures have been put in place are certainly giving residents some security, and it still seems that residents are somewhat concerned about the evacuation procedures, about identifying those manure blocks who are vulnerable, the floors that they are on, and improving the information flow between the fire brigade and residents so that if there was a need to evacuate any of these blocks, those most vulnerable could be identified and identified quickly. Is this something that the fire brigade will be looking at, and if we can work towards that? And I'm sure that it's the Bramble Road Estates Residents Association would be happy to support the task of doing this. Another matter that was raised with me by them was that there was concerns over procedures for evacuating the block, as in practices and a clear procedure that all residents should know what to do in the event if there was a fire. And this is another matter which I would ask the officers to raise with the fire brigade and liaise with the Residents Association.
Is that something we can do with the time frame on that action?
Yes, I think it is. In respect of the initial query around vulnerable residents in the block, for tower blocks, we were already there with what we call premises information boxes installed in the entrance areas of those blocks. They're only accessible via what's called a girder key, so a key that can be used, but they're very difficult to get hold of, and they're quite secure. So it's only ourselves and the fire brigade that have access to those information boxes, within which we keep things such as plans of the block itself and any information in relation to any vulnerable residents that might reside in there, so that the fire brigade are aware of who to approach first in the event of emergency. So we have that in place currently, but as part of what we're doing in the wake of what's happened at Grenfell, is contacting each of the residents and having a home visit. We're offering that if we go in there and test white goods and electrical devices such as the smoke alarms and so forth as well, which
could I ask that, I'm sure the Investment Association already in contact with the Fire Brigade, but could I ask specifically on this matter that if we have a base of local knowledge, and there may be people that haven't been contacted, that there are some liaison, there is a liaison between the Residents Association to ensure that all those potential details are up to date, that the most vulnerable are identified, those are families, those are elderly, that to ensure that we have up to date information with the focus.
So we're throwing myself and the Borough Commander for the London Fire Brigade. We'll be meeting with the Grenfell Road Residents Association on Thursday evening of this week. And we'll be happy to explore that point and a number of others that the Residents Association would like to raise.
Thank you. Councillor Mitchell.
Thank you, Chair. Can I ask Congressman Barnet Holmes if the bonnet box where plumbing system had failed the supply safety test, did those plumbing systems comply with the building regulations?
Yes, the quick answer is yes. Yes, they did. We've been in contact with Building Control College and the Council over the last week. As you can imagine, in all the work that's been going on around this, and they confirm that is their understanding of the system.
But were the fire brigade consulting when you originally decided you were going to go with that particular planning system or anything like that?
As to the exact detail of the exact conversations had at that time, I'm not able to comment currently. We can try and get some better information in respect of that. However, there are a series of things that need to be done to check and confirm as such a system, and that includes a fire safety sign-off, as well as a building control sign-off.
Would it not also need to be consulted on, sorry, the fire brigade would also need to be consulted as part of any planning application to tell the company as well?
Yes, there is a process to be gone through where the relevant fire safety experts are involved in it.
Well, can I, I'm not a member of this committee, can I request that the consultation response from the Air Fire Brigade and the Site Committee for their information that might be useful? Following on, can I also ask you give us some answers to Councillor Ryan, specifically about Granville Road. In terms of the wider Barnet Road stock, we'd be looking at potentially doing a rolling program and providing fire safety training on the home residents, and also seeing if we'd be able to provide either residents ready to purchase or some of the ski fire safety equipment in the present on kitchens.
Yes, we do have a general policy around hardwired smoke alarms in individual flats currently, and we've got them throughout the stock. And cases where they aren't, and probably why they will be hardwired in, so that's part of our general standard. But I think it's fair to say that as a result of what's happened at Grenfell, I think that's changed a great deal, and we will certainly be reviewing our entire approach to virus assessments and fire safety generally, and I think that every other landlord will probably be doing or should certainly be doing the same thing, so, and that will be a very wide-ranging sort of review of how we can deal with the fire safety process.
Thank you, Chair. And I had a member's life in Bern, which was very similar to this, and obviously I assumed that I would put the people's items in effect. I think it makes sense, because before I was asking for you, which is actually what the recommendation is. I mean, when I was put the member's life in Bern, I had, well, obviously the immediate concern of it was the day after the fire, and when I got to work out, I walked past this block and saw burn. And it was horrific. It's the worst thing I've ever seen in London. It was like, you know, you can imagine a 9/11 experience. It was people were staring and looking at it and just seeing a block at the end of the road and it burning. And one of my colleagues actually just moved out of Grenfell in March with his family. So he's been very affected by this. I think the members' item that I put down was obviously asking for what we're doing now, which is looking into the whole issue of fire safety. I specifically wanted to address the issue as well on what's happening in the private box. Because we have control of our homes, there is, as a local authority, a responsibility to show local housing associations and private landlords are actually not having faults in their head, basically. And so that was the kind of thinking behind it. I do have a couple of questions, and just a general comment about this. I do think there's a general issue with this country having created, we build a lot of high-rise blocks. They were damp and they were dreadful the way in terms of heat loss. And they were badly built, a lot of them in the 60s and 70s. And we tried to solve problems entirely with one solution to some of those problems. I think government, beyond the buzz in many ways, needs to look at this whole principle of paradox. And actually, in some cases, very much should have been demolished, actually. It should have been. It's unfit to human habitation if they do that. Quite potentially. There are issues around that, and you've only got one box going and one exit route. In the old days, London Council used to only house families on the first floor. Children weren't housed in high rise above a certain level. There's a big genuine concern about vulnerable residents, and actually at Grenfell, the fire brigade, many of whom acted heroically to save lives, their own lives, real lives, still put their own lives in danger. They didn't arrive for 6 minutes, as I understand, 6 minutes after the fire started. And that doesn't seem long, but actually it is 1 minute longer than it should have been. So I think there are issues about actually, when you've got blocks like this, having, maybe earlier, if I can survive, having actually on the ground people who are, in effect, fire wardens and can actually take some sort of responsibility to help evacuating these blocks. I think there's a whole question mark over housing blocks when people live in high rise. I think you've got a mobility problem. It seems crazy that people would do housing in high rise blocks. And I think there are also question marks, clearly, beyond this and beyond us in terms of national government resourcing this. When we have a major flooding in the Somerset levels, national government steps in and provides funding. It doesn't affect Somerset and account for the fund at all. I don't think tenants should have to pay out of the housing revenue account. And I don't think this is I think none of them want to have to dividend our housing revenue account and pay for this. Because that means less improvements, it means less development of new council homes, and actually government. And I know they have said that we need to walk them through this. Because the money that we are going to be voting on later, I hope, to provide a facility of up to 10 million shouldn't be provided by us, it should be provided by the central government. We have to vote it because we have to get on with this work, but it should be provided by the central government. I think that's quite often the failures of, this happens in the third block, that one of the points that had to come down. Who paid for that? It was tenants that paid for it. It was council tenants that paid for all the demolitions, all the worst of the fire blocks that happened in the 80s. And I just think, nationally, this programme of fire block building was driven by central government. It was driven by central government of both political colours. And actually, central government needs to face some responsibility. Because planning is there because of the rubbish that they put down the insulation for heat and everything else. So I do think there are real questions there, and I hope that we will lobby as a local authority to get that money provided by central government. Central government should really seriously look at the whole issue of power blocks and whether they're fit for purpose in the 21st century. The power blocks that were built, I'm not talking about modern old power blocks that were built in a different era, different standard. On the issue of gas, I've got a couple of questions I wanted to specifically ask in relation to gas, and a number of those have got. I have no concerns about gas in power blocks. I watched a documentary in 1984 which had one of those issues raised called The Great British Housing Disaster, and I would recommend it to anyone. It was an out of purpose film, and it goes into all this sort of whole kind of issue about power blocks. And I don't like gas in power blocks, and I know it's different from the gas that Canada, so I was a different. But I do think that one of the things we have a lot to look at is the whole issue of whether or not it is actually sensible in a fire box to have gas and actually look at what the FP London Fire Brigade latest advice. But I accept the advice is going to change the result of this fire is going to say about that. Because I think when they were originally built, gas wasn't built for most car lots. It was considered when they were built to be a lot sensible thing to do, and subsequently to put in. And that's my understanding. There wasn't around in the 60s of housing quite was around the whole thing. There was quite a lot of those days. But I do think that is an issue that we have to look at as part of this review. And I know some of this will be listed in the central government's review of this, and I'm implementing it. But I do think the other issue which has been highlighted is the issue of smoke alarms and the issue of sprinklers. And I know that's specifically something I mentioned in the members' action. I would hope that there's a commitment to look at both of those issues. I don't know why there's not smoke alarms in all communal areas in all our blocks. I think we should. I've been asked a specific question tonight by a resident about why we're tend to activate smoke alarms, fire alarms removed from blocks. There probably is a good answer to that. There might be a good answer to that, but that's something I've been asked to ask, and I would like a response from that because I've been this here tonight. And I think the other thing about the other questions actually I was going to ask have already been asked by residents actually. Terms of wires have been asked two very good questions, and I think they were asked. But I would hope that the issue of sprinklers, gas, and the issue of actually how we house people in the boxes is specifically looked at in the motion view. And the issue of if the fire brigade doesn't get there in time, and there is a great fire, have we told residents, have we informed residents, are there residents there who would act as fire warden? I've been a fire warden at work. Perhaps it's something we just need to do in terms of community, think about how do I. I think at Grenfell, a lot of residents did knock on the neighbours' doors and try to get people out. But it was hidden this. It was very much and also the advice in Grenfell also to stay in, which is the wrong advice. So just a couple of issues there. I don't know if anybody wants to come back on any of those issues. The fire alarm, smoke alarm issue.
Councillor, what I suggest doing, I think, is we split it
up into
other items. So I'll start by saying I agree with you. If money is the issue for this, the material amount of the nationwide, I certainly agree. And I think local authorities, as you phrase it, will be asking government for support in meeting those costs. I would suggest on the issue of sprinklers and gas in tower blocks that perhaps that is something we put the London Fire Brigade as part of the work we'd be seeking to do with them, but that the issue around perhaps a scheme for encouraging fire wardens and questions around housing or where vulnerable tenants are housed and what we mean by a vulnerable tenant is something that we put to Barnet Homes. Whether or not you're going to answer it tonight, if you need more time, let us know.
And I think the smoke alarm point as well, Chair, feeds back into the discussions on the fire brigade, on the kind of allocations for vulnerable tenants and those other aspects. We willingly take those away and look at them. Clearly, it isn't something we can answer tonight, but we can certainly review that as part of the wider work that we'll take.
I'm not wanting to preempt questions which might come afterwards, but I suspect that as a result of all the questions we've got tonight, there will be a paper or report produced. And just before we go any further, I'd like to check that the committee would. If the committee would be happy to receive that back as a report rather than just having it circulated, because typically with follow-up items we would have it circulated, but I think in this instance there might be some value if we actually have a report come back. So just before we go any further.
I'd say the timeliness is of the essence, so whenever
meetings in October. I mean, we do need to report back because there's something circulating that's public. And if an emergency is in the housing committee,
we have Councillor Lambert and then Councillor Lambert.
Thank you very much, Chair. I echo the remarks
councillors about the number of those who suffered in the tragedy.
We start, okay, with apologies for not giving the advance notice of this, but just before this meeting began, I received a petition from residents along with the courts in England. Just before this meeting began, I received a petition from residents of Longford Courts in Hendon behind Brent Street. And if you don't mind, I'll read out what the petition says and I'll hand it into officers afterwards. The petition reads, this petition represents the collective serious concerns and tenants of that Longford Courts. Since the catastrophic fire at Grenfell Tower, there is a real sense of fear for the safety and well-being of our families and our homes. Many of us have been unable to sleep or feel at ease in our homes since the tragedy, which was exacerbated by the lack of fire alarm system or sprinkler system in the block. We, tenants and leaseholders, appeal to you, please, as a matter of urgency, to fit a fire alarm system and sprinkler system to Longford Court. Please help us feel safe in our homes again.
I mean, in terms of, I was going to say, in terms of how to proceed, obviously, looking at this in the officers, I suspect if we're taking on board Councillor Gove's points about timeliness, would you be happy to receive a response from officers on the points raised there outside of the committee if it needs to be action sooner?
I think what would be most appropriate is, actually, I'm the least important person in this dialogue. I would. I think it would be appropriate for every resident in the courts once we agree as the principles to sort of go to inform them of what's going on and what the London Fire Brigade recommend as a matter of urgency to reassure them.
That's fine. Yeah, absolutely.
I'll move on if that's okay. The one thing that comes to mind with what's happened is it's quite clear that the residents living in Grenfell Tower and the surrounding estates have raised a number of concerns about safety and fire safety in their blocks in recent years. And for whatever reason, those concerns weren't actioned or weren't dealt with or weren't given sufficient levels of respect, perhaps from those in authority. And it reminds me of the situations I've had in West African States whereby residents collectively have raised concerns and for whatever reason it hasn't been actioned in the most timely manner. And I think what I'd like to see, if it's okay for you, Chair, is to go back over recent complaints from residents' associations, look back at complaints that are raised and whether or not actions were taken, and to take a second look at everything that has been raised, just in case, for whatever reason, perhaps it's the usual people who come along or whatever it is, just to make sure that the residents who know their homes better than anyone else, that their concerns have been looked at thoroughly, both by the council and by the fire brigade as well. So that's one. And what's your questions?
So just on that point then, because I assume we're referring to whether it is possible to get that better complaints. In terms of the time period we're looking back, are we talking, from your feeling, 6-12 months?
I think so. I can only speak to authority in West End, and bearing in mind that much of West End is no longer there anymore. But there are still a number of blocks in West End which perhaps we need to have a look at. So in the last 3 or 4 years, I would also say in Graham Park as well, I think there have been complaints raised in recent years, and I don't know if they have an action, but I know that complaints were raised, and therefore going back and just taking a second look would be useful.
And it's just looking here, the knowledge, is that something we can?
It is going to start by in specific relation to fire safety. Is that the,
So I guess I've got examples of I've had residents who informed me confidentially asking not to disclose his name or where he lives. that recent inspections in a social housing block, recommendations have been made by the authority, whether it's fire inspector or someone else, specifically around the lighting in communal areas, or around the entrance doors and the electrics, and this person didn't seem to be confident that actions were taken to address the points raised in fire inspections previously. I don't actually know where this person is, he used to tell me. But clearly, if people are getting in touch, I would imagine he's just take a second look.
Just as a clarification, perhaps just informing, just to highlight, so Longfield was due for an assessment anyway, and it would have been close to the top of our list given the height. And it was just to point out for wider members of the public that if this work is being done on Longfield, it isn't just because a petition has been signed, it's actually that it would have been based on risk. That's the phrase I'm looking for. It's just to avoid any attackers.
Either way, though, it is good to respond to residents of Bed Service. So the fact that it's a petition, then it's only a good thing to you. To responding proactively to it. Well, I've got a few questions, first question, which is connected but not directly to this, is the contractor in question, I believe were also commissioned to conduct a piece of work for us in Jordan. And whilst I make no judgment as to whether or not there are contractors who judge work or not, I am questioning whether or not we've got a backup plan, because I imagine there's going to be all sorts of legal issues that may tie down this company, and perhaps even the company may not survive sorts of lawsuits that may come forward. So just as a pointer, perhaps I need to take a look at all of your sites and see if there are what the backup options are. I'm not sure if that's been considered as well.
Yes, we have a work plan arising out of this. I should just reassure people in the first instance that the scheme that Ryan building, of course, isn't designed as a clad scheme, it's designed as a brick scheme, so there's not a concern from that point of view. But yes, on our risk register is the fact that Ryan perhaps may use some key personnel or indeed, as you said, they have other challenges, and so having a plan B in place is good, it's up as a risk. It probably hasn't been a week one, priority here, everything else is going on, but it's certainly on the point to do this.
Great. Could you keep the committee updated on this particular item? Because I imagine, again, it will be an evolving situation, and I think we would all like assurances perhaps by the next October meeting, because I think by then we'll know if the company's still in existence, what the score is, and I guess what are there any liabilities, have we paid for already, all those sorts of questions.
We may have to put it off very badly because of the commercial relationship that you have.
I'm just making a minor point. There are, as you'd expect in that type of company, a series of different legal entities. The one we're actually contracted with is different than, as part of the group, it's a different company than that did you work at that time, just to be able to be clear.
Yeah,
it's part of the same group of companies.
I make no judgments as to whether or not they're going to about the other ones. It's more about whether or not the whole group may end up being like in existence. So my next question on this is you already alluded to it, but I just want to get a clear sort of commitment that yourself and I think the leader of the council is in the gallery right now, you and all the officers will be advising the government and asking them to assist us financially in making the amendments to all costs that are involved.
Speaking formally, these various channels to say if there is money we want our fair share of that to cover costs.
And presumably, if there is not money, they should create some money, find some money somewhere.
I was certainly asking funds. Difficulties in creating money are known about them. But no point. The point is safe.
On the TV. The next question is the work that's taking place, that has to take place, to seek assurances that leaseholders will not be landed for 20,000 pound bills as they were by sending them for emergency works. And sort of commitments and stuff where leaseholders stand from the early was going to be useful.
There will be an official line, which is as per terms of your lease. However, my strong feeling is that I imagine it would be very hard to justify charging leaseholders for works which are correct. But also, I don't have any details to have. We don't know what the costs would be, but certainly I think it's going to be challenging to many leaseholders to sell.
Obviously, sort of, we've now set aside a certain amount of money to make sure later on the leasing, we will set aside a certain amount of money to make sure the works can take place as soon as possible. Have we assessed what impacts that will have on our housebuilding programme?
So we have built some houses using the HRA, which is the original tranche of homes built by Barnet Homes. Since then, we've established a registered provider subsidiary to Barnet Homes, the Open Door, which is now delivering the house building programme, which means that the house building programme is not being funded using the house revenue account, which means that we don't have any impact on taking any revenue account money to spend on our safety. It won't impact our house building programme.
Question I've not raised to Barnet Homes in relation to office to residential conversions, and they're the ones that concern me the most in terms of our private sector housing, because they are often 70s lots that have been retrofitted or cladding on them. There are a number of them, I won't mention any by name, so I don't want to scare anyone. However, I have asked other officers, but what powers do you have, if any? Or even informal powers to go to these zones who have built these blocks, often quick, cheap, get rich quick scheme, perhaps, to make sure that they open up the inspections with the same rigour as the council have.
Yeah, in terms of what the informal powers are, perhaps then to officers, I suspect the answer will be if someone at a point in time has met their legal obligation as per what the regulations were, it will be very challenging, but I will have to defer to officers.
So we have addressed this in a couple of pages in the report. If people want that level of detail. The blocks as a whole, we are really in a position where they're compliant with legislation. It's just a question of advice. If residents feel that legislation hasn't been complied with, then it would be the same as any other private landlord arrangement where we can look at the housing health and safety regulations. But as I say, the compliant with advice is a question of best, compliant with the law is a question of best practice. Then it would just be a question of your advice. We are practically talking to some landlords of blocks or trying to put some landlords of blocks where individuals and members of residents have rights concerned.
DCLG, I believe, demanded the authorities to send in samples to be tested. It wasn't a request, it was a demand from the central government. Are they making that same demand to, or do they have the power to make the same demand to private sector housing developers?
I don't know, we can look up. You can find out when you get back to you. They have the registered providers, they have demanded that. I can't see what legislation they would use to demand it. The private landlords retrospectively. It would be open to Parliament to change the building, to DCLG to change the building regulations to make them retrospectively applicable. And if they did that, then where the lines were more breaching the laws would change, which would give a route. But that's national government. So we'll find out the chapter verse for you.
So if there is no rule that allows it, could I ask this committee to officers and the chair and the shadow lead to write to our members of Parliament to seek some kind of urgent amendment or to seek the Secretary of State's guidance on this by a question of Parliament?
Again, I can't say why we wouldn't be asking for that, because the last thing anybody would want is which if it had been an RPE or council property would have been redone, and then something happens and I don't think that's a scenario we'd like. So certainly we can follow that up.
Okay, my final question is, so the Grenfell Tower fire, it appears, it's been reported it started from the hot plug fridge, starting fire. Now, have we checked to make sure that Barnet homes have provided any notice to any of our tenants? Two, are we asking during the inspection of the fire brigade some of our buildings that they are, if they're allowed in the homes, to just double check, are we issuing guidance to change them? And equally, are the RSLs also doing the same thing?
So in terms of the fire, the same as you've said, in terms of the original cause of the fire at Grenfell, what would happen when, I think it was last year, where a fire broke out in a tablet in Fulham, actually, and that was also to do with faulty appliance. And I think the appliance would subsequently then have a recall notice on that particular product. So ordinarily what we would do is when recall or any appliance, domestic appliance are issued, we would then communicate that to our residents or our website or our magazine. We have a regular safety article within that where we update people on product recalls. In terms of supplying any microwave appliances, we wouldn't do that. Ordinarily, it's not part of what the service that we would offer. So if people have to purchase microwaves, then they'll obviously be doing that outside of the arrangement that we have with them. However, having said that, in the last of Grenfell and Cranville Road, as part of the presence that we've got on the estate, we will be offering as of Wednesday, that we go and do electrical goods or appliance testing within the individual properties as part of a check that we'd like to do. Part of that will be making sure that the electricians that are actually going doing the checks are aware of all the products where recalls are currently in place against, and making sure that they do my test correctly, know that if it should be recalled that we can condemn that product at that point. Obviously there's a discussion ahead with the tenant or with the resident at that point as well. So there are things that we can do, things that we are doing.
Obviously, clearly, we're dealing with this item as a housing committee. I mean, something that an event that happened in Grenfell and anything that might be, God forbid, likely to happen in Barnet is more cross-cutting. We want committees to see it's very difficult for things of council to try and bring those things together. Last week at the Community Leadership Committee, I had an emergency motion on if an event, natural fire, terrorist activity was happening, like how we would react. There's clearly perception, true or not, that Kingston and Chelsea did not respond as we would have hoped we would have. So I just want to put that down. I think we do have quite a good record in Barnet. There have been numerous fires and emergencies every year since I've been a councillor, but I remember thinking, even once when the two nice people actually sleeping on floors in Hayes and Town Hall. So I think, you know, it is, but I'm not sure where this will actually end up. If it comes to housing, if it ends up costing resources, obviously if we come to a full council decision, I think it's hugely big. There's things about building control, there's more about things around planning, there's things around our regeneration projects that we need to take into account what happens at Grenfell. Interesting that Councillor Overland is talking about white goods, and obviously clearly there's an indication of one particular company, I believe is in their product. But it's very, very true that you haven't got much income, and if you're poor, the poorest in society, you're likely to purchase your white goods that are second-hand and reconditioned. And we must remember that we're dealing with these are vulnerable people. The way housing works these days, those people allocated properties in the social housing related sector are the most vulnerable people in the community. They're elderly, they are the parents, they're people with mental health problems, they're people who've come out of prison, have been institutionalized. So these are vulnerable people by the nature of the fact that we do not have enough social rented housing in this country, and particularly in the bottom London boroughs, and particularly in Barnet. So I think we need to know that. When we're looking at allocation policies, when we're looking at generation, we need to take that into consideration. We've also focused very much on the tower box, because obviously clearly that's the one in mind. But if you're an elderly woman, man, or a young mum with a small child in a block with three or four stories, and a fire occurs in your block with no smoke alarms, no fire alarms, and no sprinkler system in that communal area, are you really going to throw your child out of that fourth floor window? You would panic. So it isn't just tower blocks. We do need to look at. We've got a lot of properties. There are lots of properties across the borough where there are only one-bedroom flats, and therefore the nature of people housing those one-bedroom flats are very vulnerable. Grenfell Road have an active residence association. Some of those communities don't have the wherewithal to have a residence association, and I think we need to, as a council, be able to help those people. We do need mixed housing. I remember years ago, anyone knows Burton Strode Close, many, many, many moons ago, we had huge youth problems there. Barnet Council acted. We knew we had a massive number of one-bedroom properties, and the nature of the allocations in that property meant we had to do something about it. We converted those properties into family homes. We had mixed housing. So I think looking at this, we need to look at our whole, look at our housing, our housing property, how we actually think of housing in this borough. And it really, really does concern me, like the vulnerable tenancy. You know, what somebody is a vulnerable tenant may be different to someone else. So I think we really need to address that when we're looking at just housing policy across the board. Going back to Grenfell Road, I know it well, not sure many of you on the Grenfell Road estate over the years. Obviously, clearly, when it was finally the regeneration of the estate happened, I spoke to Councillor Zinke a little bit ago, and he said that the cladding basically was falling off. Somebody jokingly said that just because you contract to put cladding on within a block of flats in Barnet doesn't necessarily make it actually stay put. We said we know there was a problem with that cladding. So we should know what risk assessments were made with the contractor and the cladding before it went up and afterwards. The other thing is that, you know, how long is this going to take? It's going to be very inconvenient. I know you've got people going down to Grenfell Road to say, talking to them. It's going to be very inconvenient. And they're clearly going to be exceedingly concerned about the impact on how safe they're going to be. So I think we need to be far more addressing the problems of that. The timing of it and the assessments need to be very, very open, very public about what those assessments are. But the other thing, it is banging on the thing I was talking about in housing, is our allocations policy and our social housing remains. We were talking about private landlords. We know that in blocks like Grenfell Road and in blocks across the whole of the borough, in properties and other shops, when people come to Barnet Council to be housed, we are housing them with private landlords. We do have a responsibility to those people that we've housed. Because they've come to us and we've given an obligation to house them, they are clearly vulnerable. So it does concern me. I'm concerned about the capacity of the private sector housing team around building control, environmental health, to address any urgent class safety issues in the private sector. In blocks, in flats, in shops. One of my items of last week I bought was about the fire in that particular in Goldsbury Road. We know we've had quite a few fires in flats in Goldsbury for some years. So I think we have a responsibility, whether it's the housing committee, whether it's policy resources, whether it's planning, we need to address the concerns. We shouldn't be having fires in 2017 like we saw 2 weeks ago last week. That shouldn't be happening in 2017. I think we need to reassure that everybody, whether private tenants, a council tenants, or a homeowner in the lease block, that this is not going to happen to you. The images of those firemen driving to that fire, who couldn't believe how, I won't use the language, how could it happen, is something that we need to all take home. God forbid anything like this would happen. We've had, I think the last 2 months, for all of us has been very, very difficult for numerous reasons, and this sort of brought something back home. Why we all became in councils, why we're all involved in politics, is to make life better for people, not to make it worse. We need to strive that something like this would never happen in Barnet, and if it does, we're there to react properly. But it isn't about, it does seem to me is that this situation should never occur in the richest borough in the UK. Barnet's pretty well off. God forbid anything like that, and any resident of this borough could fear that that could happen to them. I just need the reassurance. I know it's difficult. I know the pressures on people who work in housing. I wouldn't want to be in housing because it's so, so hard to try and fulfil the expectations of people who come to you on a daily basis. But it's something we've got to get right.
I'm a co support of the said, and would also say for any councillors who haven't yet, for whatever reason, physically seen the site to go and either drive past and
it's not a tourist attraction, I don't
know. No. I don't mean in terms of tourist attraction, I mean in terms of helping to bring home women actually. Men, there's someone, you know, similar to Cassie who's not here, who works there, someone who drove past it shortly afterwards, seeing the building standing there compared to what is around it, it certainly brings home the need to do something to ensure that, as you say, it doesn't happen again. Cassie,
yeah, I'm just wondering a couple of things. They are